Good morning. Today is the 23rd day of December 2016, and we are honored to have Kittu Reddy back with us. Welcome, Kittu. This will be part three of the human cycle. As I've previously mentioned, Kittu has been with us 9 times already, and this is the 10th. So we're very pleased.
So I'll first give a very quick resume of the first 5 chapters.
Okay.
The fundamental point is that society evolves through psychological stages. And Sri Aurobindo mentioned here 5 psychological stages: symbolic, typal, conventional, individualistic and rational, and finally subjective. None of these are watertight. They flow broadly one into another and they can coexist simultaneously. So in the 4th chapter, he has illustrated subjectivism in collective life, because this book is about society, through the nation. This concept of nation is not merely geographical, economic, external, political. It is subjective. So when someone loves a nation, it's a subjective statement, because the nation has a subjective existence. It is not merely a piece of outward land, right? And all patriots feel that subjective element strongly. But then there is subjectivism and subjectivism. There can be a very degrading subjectivism coming from the lower vital. There can be a very uplifting psychologism, subjectivism, which comes from the psychic being or the spiritual center. And therefore, he introduces a concept of true and false subjectivism. And this is very important for all those who are doing sadhana, whether here or outside. Because by the very fact that you are doing sadhana, you are trying to come into contact with some subjective element deeper, which will be your guide. Now, if you make an error there and think that you have heard the voice of the divine or the mother and actually heard something else, it can be very serious and very dangerous. And we have had examples in the ashram where somebody in Sri Aurobindo's time heard a voice to go and jump into the well. So he jumped into the well. Evidently it was a voice that was from the lower world. Individually, if we go wrong, it's bad for us and bad for those who are around us. But when a nation goes wrong subjectively, it can have catastrophic effects. And he illustrates Germany as an example of false subjectivism. Because Germany was in the 19th century, second half, one of the leading nations in the world, technologically, culturally, from the point of view of music, from the point of view of literature. They naturally had a sense of greatness and glory. But unfortunately, this was turned into a very aggressive, dominant instinct. And Hitler exemplifies that perfectly. So Hitler was a kind of Asuric force, lower subjectivism, who used to hear voices and be guided by those voices. So that is extremely dangerous. At the same time, there can be a beautiful, higher, nobler, wider subjectivism. And that is what Sri Aurobindo expects from India. That is the role that India has to play in the world. To go into that deeper subjectivism on the national plane. And that's why Mother has said that India is meant to be the guru of the world. Is meant to be, not yet. And that can happen only when we have touched the deeper subjectivism and brought it into our national life. So, broadly, these are the first five chapters. In the sixth chapter, he speaks about the objective views of life and the subjective views of life. In the objective view of life, you stand out. You stand back and watch the object from outside. Then you discover laws of the object, of the, let us say, machine. And then you apply those laws for improving, changing, correcting. We can do the same thing with our body. Stand outside, understand the whole body, anatomy and physiology, the functioning of the body, and make the necessary corrections, which every doctor is doing. But when you are absolutely rational, the psychological element is removed. But in the case of a human being, the psychological element has to be brought in. So the extreme objective point is standing outside, looking at the tape recorder, like a machinery. Extreme subjective point is that everything happens from inside. So, in the subjective viewpoint, it is first self-recognition, then self-realization, and then self-expression. Self-recognition. Look at oneself from inside, all the good and bad points. Self-realization, find out the true center. Then self-manifestation. From that center you can express. So this is the subjective view of progress. Actually, in all life, both are mixed. In the Western mind, it is more objective and external. In the Asiatic Indian mind, it is more subjective and internal. The fact is that both are needed. So when you are ill, there has to be an objective evaluation. Purely by the doctor who checks up everything externally. But then you can help the cure not only by medication, which is mechanical, but by a kind of subjective process, helping it by consciousness, etc., etc. You can carry it to the two extremes. But for most human beings, it has to be a combination of the two. So this is the sixth chapter. In the seventh chapter, it's a very typical Sri Aurobindonian way of doing things. He brings in the ideal law of social development, which is quite futuristic. And there he discusses in great depth the relation between individual and the collectivity, between individuals and individuals, between individuals and small groups, between groups and groups, and between humanity and the individual. So it is a whole range. But the final last two paragraphs, he says the secret of finding this law is self-realization. You cannot, by the objective external methods, arrive at this concept of understanding. So self-realization is the key. So with this he ends the seventh chapter. Now the next 10 or 11 chapters, it's no more society. It is the individual. I'll explain why. Since self-realization is a key to progress, both individual and collective, and since the collectivity is made up of individuals, the process is very similar. Therefore, it is better to start with the individual, who is our index. And you multiply this and you have the same thing in a society. So when you want to have a spiritual society, it is not enough to have one or two individuals. It is a big help, it's the beginning. But then the mass gradually has to move up into that. So he's taking up the individual. The next question that automatically comes in, self-realization. Where is the self? Very easy to say self-realization. But where is the self? So he says, the first initial natural movement in human evolution is that the self identifies itself with the body. This body is myself. And then he goes further one step and says that when you identify yourself, a group or a civilization identifies itself entirely with the body, that is a stage of barbarism. So barbarism is that state when the society primarily identifies itself with the body, with the physical needs, desires, urges, and only that. You have to look at life as well as oneself. There are elements of that within us also. But you can look at life and you will find that there are people who are only and only in the physical being. Very few today with education and mental development, the number is decreasing. But certainly there are a few yet who are only identified with their body, with their needs, with their desires, with their physical longings. So this is the primary stage of barbarism. Inevitably, as the process of evolution, one moves to the next stage, where the self is a vital being. The physical being is the base, but then there comes the vital being. And that identification with the vital being means to possess more and more, to have more and more, because that is the nature of the vital being. Unless the vital is touched by a higher thing, it's only greed and desire and accumulation, right? So Sri Aurobindo says the opulent plutocrat is the occult ruler of society. Occult means secret. Is it a fact today? And even today in the world, in the civilized world more particularly, the opulent plutocrat, the one with a lot of money, is the most powerful man, although he might not be in power, but he has a lot of power. So now this stage is what he calls vital barbarism. So from that point of view, he says that almost all the European nations, modern nations, are in that stage of vital barbarism. And from that point of view, he even says that ancient India, ancient Greece, many of the ancient civilizations were far more developed in the art of living than the modern nations. We have to pass a certain condemnation on them. Because all this knowledge has been used for pure, selfish, vital gains.
Now, Sri Aurobindo wrote this, The Human Cycle, in what year?
Between 1918 and 20.
Is it true today that the same barbarism exists?
It is better, but it is true.
I see.
You have to answer me. The big powers, America, Russia, the powerful ones, they have intervened everywhere in the world.
Yes.
For noble purposes or for selfish purposes. One answer.
Yeah, it's pretty clear, isn't it?
Huh?
It's pretty clear that it's selfish purposes.
So that is barbarism.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
You get it?
Yes.
See, weaker nations cannot, so we can't say that they are not barbaric. But a nation that is strong and intervenes only in the most unselfish way, that is the answer, right? Not to be weak, not to misuse your strength. That is called vital barbarism. And colonialization, what is it?
Sure.
It is nothing else but vital barbarism. You can justify it under any color.
So we have, we have England, Spain.
England, France, Spain, Portugal, absolutely.
Yeah.
America more subtly, right? Because, you know, the domination and exploitation is not necessarily military and physical. It can be economic. It can be indirectly political. And today it is economic motives that drive powerful nations to continue to be able to dominate. Right? So he will call that economic barbarism.
Okay.
Right? See, this vital instinct of dominating, exploiting, in whatever form, is barbarism. You, I, if we do it, it is barbarism, but its impact is small. But when a big nation does it, right, then it becomes a very serious thing. I cannot pretend that that has gone out of the system. It is there. But things have changed. Might have to digress a little bit. Things have changed because of the two world wars. The First World War was fought between civilized, imperial, and wanting to be imperial nations. England, France, Italy on one side, Germany on the other side. All of them were driven by this vital greed. Now, when you have so much greed, the war took place. The lesson was not deeply learnt. So a Second World War had to be fought. See how nature does things. And this time they brought somebody who carried this disease of domination to the extreme, Mr. Hitler. Don't ever pretend that the English and the French were angels. They were also doing the same thing. But when you had to make a choice between the two, Hitler was worse, because then the whole world would have been finished. England, France, some kind of democracy was there, at least in their own country. So then the idea can spread. So after the Second World War, by carrying the disease to its extreme point, it was very difficult to put on a cover. The result is that almost all the nations became free over a period of time. 197 nations today, or even more. And that's why Mother said that it is already decided that India will become free in 1920, because it will be the world forces that will compel this to change the international situation, and then one by one they all became free. So sometimes you have to carry a disease to its extreme point. Then the disease becomes, you know, blatantly visible. Otherwise, you go on covering up, pretending, right?
Now, after World War II, what about Communist Russia and China, Korea?
Communist Russia, immediately after the Second World War, was extremely dangerous. And I would say the disease was transferred from the imperial countries, slightly at least, to Stalin. That's why when the Korean War erupted, when North Korea invaded South Korea, and then China joined in afterwards, and Russia also joined in afterwards. I was reading this letter this morning. Amal Kiran asked, he said, why? There is no problem. It's as clear as a pikestaff. If America does not intervene now, sooner or later, the communists will dominate the whole of Asia. They will take up Tibet, then they will take up India, and then they will try to take up the whole world. So it is high time that America intervened. And President Truman was dilly-dallying, but finally he decided to intervene. He even threatened to use the nuclear bomb. And Sri Aurobindo was supportive that if it is absolutely necessary, right? So all this pacifism, he doesn't believe. All life is a battle. And well, when it is needed, you have to take very stringent measures. So anyway, that is vital barbarism. Vital barbarism has not been eliminated even today from the international field. But today it is very difficult for a country A or B to send their armies, and so there are other ways, much subtler ways. The main thing is economic, right? So it can be economic sanctions, it can be this. So Russia was a very dangerous power at that time. And communism under Mao Zedong was extremely, was almost on the same type, right? Today the whole world has realized that Russia has changed completely after the advent of Gorbachev, and right? Russia has not given up communism, but it has given up that extremely aggressive position of trying to dominate the world. And it is good that they have not given up communism, because there is a deep truth in communism, just as there is a deep truth in democracy, right? So freedom is as important as equality, fundamental equality. To hell with equality and freedom, nonsense. To hell with freedom and level up everybody, another nonsense. The ashram is an excellent example of a beautiful harmony between freedom and equality. On principle, at least. You see, equality, everybody gets his food, gets his clothing, gets his housing, gets his medical treatment. His basic needs of life are securely met. And there is a fair amount of freedom, which is used or misused, that is another matter. But could have suppressed the freedom. Luckily, they have not done it, and it won't be done, right? So it's a fairly good harmony, right? So this has to be the principle of the world. Extreme forms of communism means you completely control the society. extreme forms of what you call democracy or capitalism means the rich get richer and richer and they don't care at all for the rest. Neither of them are true. You have to come in between somewhere. This coming in between has brought in a new pattern. It's called socialism, where the state, the government, takes control of a big chunk of your life, but also gives you a fair amount of freedom. Today, every country in the world is democratic socialist or socialistic democratic. Russia is socialist democratic. China is still communist. America is definitely democratic socialist. India is very much on the middle, a little more democratic sometimes. And this is necessary because there are so many poor people. You have to stand by them. You have to help them to stand by themselves, etc., etc. The previous governments were giving out doles. This government is trying to make you stand on your own feet. A little dole at the beginning, but then once you stand on your own feet, it's finished, right? Instead of giving you fish, I teach you how to fish. So, this is socialism, right? But combined with capitalism, because then you start earning your own money, then you start, right? Then other problems might start, but at least you have to give them that much. So, vital barbarism is the next stage. And Aurobindo says that it is worse than physical barbarism. The physical barbarian, crude, what we'll call jungly, you can't expect much, a different behavior from him. But I have been civilized, educated, I have the money, and I do the same thing in a much worse fashion, right? That is lowering of the consciousness, right? Not raising up of the consciousness. That you have to watch and look at life, right? And you will find sometimes in the primitive tribes, I was reading a few days back, Ubuntu in Africa. The food was there, you run the race, and whoever gets the food first, he gets it. They said, no, 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 we all run together and go and get it. Because we all need each other, we all live together. See, now this is psychology, that we are all going together towards the same thing. So it is there on the internet in a very big way today, right? And it is a message, and from whom? African tribes, whom we call barbarian, because they don't have the cameras and the telephone and the this and the that, right? The gadgets of modern civilization. You don't have to reject that, but the psychology must be that we all share. So this is vital barbarism. It's not over. Then you move to the mental stage. And here, very important, because it is very, very widespread and hardly recognized. When you move to the mental stage, you enter into a stage called mental barbarism, because your mind is trained. Your mind is developed. You can see the TV, you can read newspapers, you can apparently form judgments. But he calls these people who read newspapers, TVs and this and that and have opinions about everything as Philistines. It's a worse form of mental barbarism than physical barbarism. Because today he says all the newspapers, TV channels, etc., 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 are giving opinions based on their own perception of things. It is not the proper use of mind. The proper use of mind will inevitably mean that you look at all the viewpoints before you even arrive at a judgment. You get all the data before you even pass a judgment. And if you don't do that, but today the media, right, is absolutely, you can be this side, you can be that side. Yesterday I got a news that CNN has deliberately not mentioned this thing. It's inconvenient, right? Deliberately not mentioned this. And they take sides. Trump has won the election, he's going to get into power. So you deliberately ignore some of the good things that he has said and build up on the bad things that he has said. So you see, now this is philistinism, pure and simple. And this is barbarism. Is this more dangerous than the physical barbarism? Who is more dangerous?
But what about vital versus mental?
Vital barbarism is the servant of the mind becomes the servant of the vital. I have greed and I want to dominate, etc., etc. Mm-hmm. Here I am justifying all my greed. Right? Because I am intelligent. I can present a viewpoint, etc., etc. See, this is going on all the time today. See, in the Islamic religion, it has been so for a long time. It is probably breaking up. But India has decided that this system of talak, where a husband can go and just divorce her, is unfair. It violates human dignity. It violates the woman's dignity. Big conflict. The traditionalist is, you have no right to interfere in our religion. We will do what we think is right. He says religion is inferior. Now, then the argument starts, religion, constitution, human values are superior, right? Now, this treating a woman like this, what kind of barbarism? On the physical plane, vital plane, it is both. And you are justifying it with the mind.
Yes.
Then it is mental barbarism.
Yes.
You do something wrong, you have sex with somebody against her will, it is wrong. And you say, I have made a mistake. But when you justify it, right? So this is the most dangerous thing. So, as mother says, almost all the perversions in human life have come with the mind. Animals are not perverse. They never kill unless it is needed for them to eat or to defend themselves. We kill for the sheer pleasure of killing. Right? So perversity starts with man.
I have been reading about this sexual grooming.
Sexual?
Grooming in England, where men gather together and force young girls, take them to apartments and everything else. It's a huge blow-up in England now.
It was there in India, where more than a few trillion rupees were being spent. People who would do this, they would go and pick up a village girl, 12-year-old, 13-year-old, ready for beginning to have sex, right? Elope her, take her, ultimately sell her for 2.5 lakh rupees. Rich people would do that. And then she would go into what is known as the flesh market. Right? It was a huge, huge racket. Trillions and trillions of rupees. In one stroke, Narendra Modi has smashed it. All that money has become blank, zero. So now they can't, they have no money to spend, no? So they have to get new notes new notes have to come to the bank. Finished. It's a huge, huge step. See, it is pure vital barbarism of the lowest type, encouraged by whom? By the rich people.
By the mind.
Right? The wealthy.
Yes.
Vital barbarism, using their intelligence.
Yes.
Mental barbarism, right?
Yes.
This is a very crude form. But then every time we have to be very careful. Every time we pass opinions, judgments, you are likely to be a Philistine, which is mental barbarism. Because you see, if you are rationally, if you want to make a judgment, there is a process. First is you must collect the data. You must know everything about what you want to pass a judgment. You must get all the information. If you get half information, it won't be correct. So that itself takes time. So that is the first step. Then you have to classify them so that it becomes easier to handle. Then you have to analyze. And that's a process where you will find that it needs a certain intelligence and a good comprehension.
Yes.
Then you come to a conclusion. All planning that we do is based on that. You collect the data, you classify it, analyze it, and then take the next step. That is how the human mind works. But when we are passing opinions about especially politics, I mean, what is the information that we have got? Hardly anything. See?
Yeah.
That is why Mother says, observe, watch, don't pass opinions. Right? So, every time you pass an opinion about something, just catch yourself and say, I am a mental barbarian. Unless you have got full information. And even then, it is possible, it seems, I believe that it is so. You look carefully at Sri Aurobindo. You read any of his books. Always, it seems, it is possible, it could be. Now, he takes a position that it seems to me that this is the best position. Then if you accept that it seems, then the logical conclusions follow. But if you don't accept that it seems, you can knock it out. Right? So the very first sentence of the human cycle, modern science obsessed with the discoveries, physical discoveries, and the sole existence of matter. Therefore, yesterday my nephew came to me, he said, there are scientists who will still tell you that it's the sole existence of matter. That nothing else exists. It is a product of matter. We have not discovered it, but we will discover it. Right? So, Sri Aurobindo will say that there is a point of view that has come, which explains that there is some, you can look at it from another way. And then if you accept that possibility, then these are the conclusions. Right? So Sri Aurobindo is never aggressive. He is always giving you a point of view, which it is for you to decide. Then when you read the point of view and you find that it is the most satisfying, then automatically you follow him. Until then, so this is very important. Huh? So, physical barbarism, vital barbarism, mental barbarism. And I would say that the newspapers and the TVs are entirely, or almost entirely, evidences of mental barbarism. It is very rarely that you get someone who is objective, someone who looks from the higher point of view, someone who looks from a more detached, when I say higher, I'm not speaking of spiritual, who speaks of fundamental ideas and then illustrates, right? That is distinctly a step in the right direction, right? So, to become a developed, fully developed mental being is itself a huge sadhana. And I've read, I can't quote exactly, I think both Madhura and Sri Aurobindo, that the first important thing is to become a mental being, a truly mental being. For those who are doing sadhana, of course the psychic is the most important, but the development of the mind is as important or secondary, because otherwise you can't express anything. In order to express, not through music, but through word, right? You have to have a developed mind. And that is exactly Sri Aurobindo. 35 volumes. I don't know if anybody has written so much, such a massive content. So, physical barbarism, vital barbarism, mental barbarism, then the true mental being. Right? So then from there, he shifts. Shifts means he gives it another word, barbarism, civilization and culture.
Shall we take a few minutes break?
Yes, yes.
And we can begin on that.